So thank you very much for this impressive introduction. Once again, my name is Nikola Miskovic, and before I give you a talk about cooperative and not-so-cooperative marine robots, I need to define two things. And those are, just to turn this on, and those are what Croatia means and what Zagreb means. So I'm sure that many of you are not aware of that, but the laboratory that I come from is a part of the University of Zagreb, that's the capital of Croatia, a part of the Faculty of Electrical Engineering and Computing. Laboratory is called Laboratory for Underwater Systems and Technologies, and it's positioned somewhere around here. So this is the world, this is Europe, and this beautiful small pretzel is Croatia. You can see it in more details here, and this is Zagreb, so the capital of Croatia. We have a population of around 4.2 million people. That's, I think, like one neighborhood in any Indian city, right? And we have about 56,000 square kilometers of area. Another thing that we have is a very beautiful coastline. And this coastline motivates us to do marine robotics. So my lab is here, but this is a 1-hour drive to the coast where we do most of our experiments. Now, Croatia has 7 universities. My university, University of Zagreb, being the biggest one, with more than 60,000 students spread in different faculties, engineering, humanities, and different academies and art schools. So if you have any more questions about Croatia, I would be happy to answer them. Let's now say a few words about the Laboratory for Underwater Systems and Technologies. I just want to say that our main activity is doing research and development, but of course we are deeply involved in educating our students. Most of the research that we perform is interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary, and we like to call it applied research. So everything that we do, we like to have an application or why we do that. Currently, there's 12 people in the lab, and I have to mention that only Professor Vukic and myself are permanent faculty members. Everyone else is employed in research projects that are being conducted within the laboratory. So, having said that, I'm going back to the title, cooperative and not so cooperative robots, marine robots. I will not go into detail on how to make cooperation between the robots. There are many textbooks and there's many material for you to learn how to do cooperation. What I would like to focus on is some specific projects that are being run in my laboratory that might give you ideas for future R&D activities in the area of cooperative robots. So to start off with, does anyone have any idea what this is? It's an underwater mine. And the problem is not in a single underwater mine, but the problem is that there are many underwater mines, unexploded ordnance, that is available, unfortunately, in the whole of Mediterranean. Most of it is here in the Adriatic, but we also have a lot of underwater mines in the North Seas of Europe. The main reason for this are First World War, Second World War, and many local wars that were run during the last century. So, what's the problem with these underwater mines? If an underwater mine explodes, well, if a mine explodes in the underwater, the radius of destruction is much greater in comparison to the mine exploding on dry land, because these waves propagate much farther. That's why unexploded underwater ordnance is a very, very big difficulty for tourism, for performing underwater operation, and many other things. So for that purpose, we teamed up with the NATO Center at CMRE in order to devise a novel cooperative robotic system that is capable of performing mine countermeasures. This robotic system consists of an autonomous surface vehicle, an autonomous catamaran called Gemelina, and an autonomous underwater vehicle that is based on the video array vehicle design. We only made this autonomization module. So the main idea between this project was to have this cooperative system that works in the following way. So this is the name of the project. The main operation of the system is as follows. So the underwater vehicle is positioned on the surface vehicle that has a multi-beam sonar detecting where the potential unknown object is. Once it is found in the sonar image, the underwater vehicle is automatically deployed from the surface vehicle and guided within the sonar, within the multi-beam sonar image, in order to take it to the position where the unknown object is located. So here you will see what the multi-beam sonar image looks like. Here is the underwater vehicle that we are guiding. This is about 50 meters distance, and we want the vehicle to come here. This vehicle does not have any navigation sensors on it. It's completely blind. The only thing it can hear instructions from the surface vehicle whether it should go a little bit to the right or a little bit to the left. I'm oversimplifying, of course, but this is the concept that we try to exploit for the purpose of detecting unidentified objects at larger distances underwater. So this is the basic cooperation that we have between the surface vehicle and an underwater vehicle. Let's go a step further and say, okay, I want to do cooperation of this form. In addition to having a surface vehicle and one underwater vehicle, why wouldn't I have multiple underwater vehicles? And let's make it even more complicating, and I'll put a few aerial vehicles in this cooperative formation. This is a European project that we participated in, and the main goal of this project was to detect oil spills in the underwater environment. So, the real vehicles that we were using are here. So we had three AUVs, one aerial vehicle, and one surface vehicle. And this is a part of my team. The other guys are from Spain and Greece. Just to give you a glimpse of some of the results of this project, which is called Autonomous Underwater Vehicles Ready for Oil Spill, where four institutions participated from Europe. So this is the main concept that I described to you already. And this is the aerial vehicle that was used. You can see the way the aerial vehicle is deployed. These are the underwater vehicles and the surface vehicle that I was telling you about. So the main concept is this. I want to have an underwater vehicle scanning, surveying an area in the underwater, and in case it finds an oil, it should go to the surface, communicate with the aerial vehicle, and then the aerial vehicle will be a sort of a data mule and transmit this information to the surface. Another concept that we were testing was to have an underwater vehicle and the surface vehicle cooperatively following this underwater vehicle to have almost real-time data transmission via the acoustic link to the surface station. So this is what experiments look like. The red thing is called rhodamine. Of course, we couldn't pour oil into the sea in order to do experiments. That's not allowed by our friends environmentalists. So we put rhodamine, which is a biodegradable substance that we can also detect using similar sensors as we would if we were detecting oil. Here you can see the view from the aerial vehicle, and you can identify the two underwater vehicles. And here is the command center or the software where we could see the position of each of these vehicles. You can see the red point. What do we do with this? What happens when we detect that there is an oil spill? Then we feed it into a simulation model that tells us a prediction where the oil spill is going to go to so that we can take preventive measures in time to prevent hazardous catastrophes on coastlines. Okay, so this was a bit more complicated cooperative system where we included aerial vehicles. But you can see that in this project, we had mostly communication within this heterogeneous robotic system. One other project, which is NATO-funded project, involved also aerial vehicles and underwater vehicles. But in this project, we wanted to achieve physical interaction between the aerial vehicle and the underwater vehicle. Imagine this situation. So this is a part of the Croatian coast. And here is a beautiful national park called the National Park Kornati with thousands of islands. So imagine you have an underwater vehicle performing a habitat survey here. And then all of a sudden, you get information from the radar that an unknown ship is entering your territorial waters somewhere around here. So what I want to do as an operator from the coast, I want to make sure that this underwater vehicle stops with this mission, and I want to somehow transport this vehicle to this position in order to monitor whether the ship is releasing ballast waters or doing something hazardous for the environment. So, underwater vehicles, they have long autonomy. They can be in water for 8 hours, let's say. but they do not have the capability of going from traveling far distances. On the other hand, aerial vehicles, they have short autonomy, they can be in air for a limited amount of time, but they have the capability of traveling far large distances. So for that purpose, we said, okay, let's combine these characteristics between the aerial vehicle and the underwater vehicle. We want to achieve that the aerial vehicle collects the underwater vehicle, which is at the sea surface. We want to transport it to the point B and redeploy it at point B. So this project, as I already mentioned, funded by NATO, has recently started. And what we currently have is we have one simulation result that I would like to show you. We are now working on developing an aerial vehicle that is capable of lifting a 50-kilo payload. In order to have that, you need to have an aerial vehicle with gasoline engines. Otherwise, it wouldn't be able to. The ones that you can buy in shops or whatever, in supermarkets, they do not have this type of capability because they have electrical motors. So we have already developed this aerial vehicle with gasoline engines, and now we are working on the control system, how to nicely control it using a moving mass system. Okay, we'll just wait for the aerial vehicle to pick up this underwater vehicle. And with that, I will conclude this type of cooperation where we have physical interaction between an aerial vehicle and an underwater vehicle. This is going much slower than I thought. We should work on that. Okay, good. It's much more complicated in real life, of course. This is the concept to demonstrate what we are aiming for doing. But this was all very nice. Working with robots, you can tell the robot what to do. You can ensure cooperation between the robots. The problem comes when you have a non-cooperative node, a human. The first thing that we wanted to do is, since we work a lot with divers, we wanted to develop a system that would help the divers navigate and communicate underwater. So here what you can see are results of an initial project where we had a diver and we developed an autonomous surface vehicle that acted as a private satellite for the diver. Surface vehicle tracking the diver at all times, ensuring the shortest acoustic communication path between the diver and the vehicle, and thus propagating GPS coordinates and messages to the diver below. What we did is for the first time, we enabled the usage of Google Maps underwater. Not only that, but we enabled sending chat messages through commercially available tablets. So we are using the Samsung tablet to communicate and to transmit this GPS information. So this was the first time that we encountered with not-so-cooperative marine robots. And then we said, okay, in addition to having the surface autonomous vessel assisting the diver, why wouldn't we do something a little bit more science fiction? Why wouldn't we introduce autonomous underwater vehicles cooperating with the divers? So this is the idea that came almost 10 years ago in cooperation with our friends from Portugal, Instituto Superior Técnico from Lisbon. And with this image, we came up with a project called CADI, Cognitive Autonomous Diving Buddy. This was a 3-year European-funded project that ended last year. And what we wanted to do within this project, we wanted to enhance the combination of diver and the surface vehicle with an additional autonomous underwater vehicle. We wanted to achieve synergy between a human diver and underwater autonomous, marine autonomous vehicle. So in order to achieve that, we used an autonomous surface vehicle that, as in the previous case, acted as a private satellite for the diver. And for this purpose, we were using Medusa vehicles developed by our Portuguese partners. For the underwater vehicle, what we wanted the underwater vehicle to do, we want the underwater vehicle to always be somewhere in the vicinity of the diver, to observe the diver at all times, and to help the diver. So for this purpose, We developed a one-of-a-kind underwater vehicle that is the first underwater vehicle for interaction with the divers. In addition to all the classic conventional components such as thrusters and proprioceptive sensors, we had an underwater tablet that is here that issues commands to the diver or gives the diver status of the current progress of the mission. In addition, of course, to all these things, we had stereo cameras and we had the multi-beam sonars. You will see the results a bit. You will see the results a bit later. This is what the vehicle looks like. So we really made it, you know, so we did experiments with it. And now, so this is the whole idea of the Caddy project. What we wanted to do with these vehicles. First, we wanted to implement three basic features in our Caddy system. We wanted to have a dive observer, an underwater vehicle capable of looking at what the diver is doing, and not only looking what the diver is doing, but maybe even anticipating whether the diver will come to a hazardous situation soon and try to prevent it in time. In order to have this dive observer, what we did, we used, of course, stereo cameras for the underwater. We used multi-beam sonars to see what the diver is doing. But we also developed this system of nodes that are distributed, inertial nodes that are distributed on the diver body. We call this system diver net. So you have these nodes on the diver body. All these measurements are collected in the diver tablet and acoustically sent to the surface. What this allowed us is to observe what the diver is doing at the surface in real time. Here you will see one of the results of the experiments that were taken during the final validation trials. Here you can see a video that's the point of view from the diver. Point of view from the body vehicle. This is the multi-beam sonar image of the diver from the body vehicle point of view. And this is the 3D replay of all the data that we collected during the experiment. You can see that this 3D avatar, a virtual human, is doing exactly the same things as this one. And this is possible because of this network of sensors that we put on the diver's body. So what we now have is we have the situation when we can replay the whole mission with the diver, with the underwater vehicle and the surface vehicle, and observe what the diver is doing. You could have noticed that while we are observing all these things, the body vehicle is always positioning itself relative to the diver at a specified distance. And if the diver rotates, the vehicle will also rotate to stand in front of the diver, because we want to be in front of the diver at all times. The second functionality that we were interested in is to ensure that we have a dive guide. As I mentioned, divers in the underwater, they do not have GPS. So the easiest way to guide a diver from point A to point B is to have an arrow in front of the diver pointing him in which direction the diver should go. And this is exactly what we did. Our concept was to position our vehicle in front of the diver in such a way to point the diver to the direction in which he should go. So if this is the point where we want to guide the diver, the vehicle will go a little bit to the right to tell the diver, to let the diver know that he should go a little bit to the right. Okay, so this is the concept, but now you will see what it looks like during the real experiment. Again, point of view from the body vehicle, and you can see that the body is a little bit to the right relative to the diver. Because what we are now trying to tell the diver is, okay, I'm positioned here, you should go a little bit to the right so that you would reach the position where I want to guide you. So that was the second functionality. And the third functionality that we wanted to have is to have a dive slave. We want to have an underwater robot that helps the diver during diving operations. In order to have somebody help you, you need to be able to communicate with this robot. So initially what we did is we developed a hand-based gesture signal, a hand-based symbol language that is based on hand gestures. Yeah, I said something wrong, but okay. Where we established communication between the diver and the underwater vehicle. Diver is giving hand signals to the underwater vehicle, while the underwater vehicle is providing feedback through the tablet to the diver. At this moment, the diver is telling the vehicle to take a photo of this area below. In this experiment that we did, the diver, so this is an experiment in real life conditions, this is the Adriatic. Well, it's not the ocean, so we don't have that many environmental disturbances, but it is the sea. The diver is issuing the command to his body vehicle to go to the surface, to the boat, and pick up a piece of equipment that the diver has, that the diver has forgotten. So now you will see, once the body vehicle acknowledges, okay, it acknowledged the command, it will go to the surface, rotate, and go to the boat to execute the mission that was issued by the diver. Okay. So these are the main three functionalities that we introduced in our CADI system. And this is the work that we did with the divers. The divers, who for us are non-cooperative nodes, because you cannot tell a human what to do. You can instruct him, but he or she will always do what they want. Another form of non-cooperative marine robotics would be swarm robotics. So, having mentioned that, imagine that we have a completely artificial underwater society that consists of 120 artificial muscles. So this is what the A muscle looks like. And this is what 10 A muscles look like during our last experience. We are now in the process of developing, of making, fabricating 120 of these in order to perform experiments. I will just quickly show you one of the experiments that we did with these A muscles. The communication, so these A muscles, they have acoustic communication, but they also have blue light communication, something that Ken mentioned during his talk. So what we did is we try to exploit this blue light communication by having three A muscles at the seabed, and now I'm sending the fourth A muscle with the information which of these A muscles should go up. So I'm taking one and telling, look, you go down, and you make sure that this one goes up. So once the fourth one came down, did it come down? Yeah, it did. So once this fourth one came down, it started communicating with other A muscles. And now what should happen is that this A muscle should come up because the fourth one came down and told her, okay, they want you at the surface. So this is, okay, there it is. So we are working on communicating with the 120 nodes at the seabed. And this is much more complex than you would imagine. Because when you do these experiments at the surface, you have wireless connection and communication is not a problem. In the underwater, where you have quite elementary acoustic communication, there is a lot of research potential that can advance this area. One other thing that we are working on in this project is ensuring that artificial lilypads, apeds, can recharge A muscles. So I told you that apeds have this fork with inductive chargers. So what we are working on is we want to have, I have a video somewhere, yeah. So what we want to have is the aped has a camera on it. And this is an experiment where the aped is completely autonomous, looking for the A muscle. Once it finds the A muscle, it locks onto it, opens the fork, goes towards the A muscle, and once it grabs it, closes the fork and starts charging the A muscle. So this is a part of a larger system where we want to have five of these surface platforms charging 120 A muscles for the purpose of achieving long-term sustainability in the ocean. Okay, so that's about it when it comes to the subcultural project. And to the last part of cooperative, non-cooperative marine robots. Before I finish my talk on these robots, I would like to, I would just like to promote our workshop. I hope you do not mind. So, Breaking the Surface is a workshop in Croatia where we join together people from marine robotics, marine biology, marine archaeology, and marine security. This workshop is mainly intended for PhD students and master students, and this year it's taking place in the first week of October. It will be the ninth time that we are organizing this workshop, and you can see that in previous years, well, in last year, we had 30 experts who were giving lectures. Mandar was one of them. We had 10 vehicle demonstrations and more than 200 participants. So these are the program tracks that we have during the one-week workshop. And I really did my best to try and find Mandar's provocative photo from the workshop, but this is the most provocative I could find. It's Mandar behind his computer, so it wasn't really. But in addition to having a professional workshop, we also have fun. I can't believe that I didn't take a photo of Mandar with these things. Well, at least I couldn't find it. So this year, hopefully. So if you want to have no more details, please visit bts.fer.hr. And with this, I would like to summarize my talk. And if there are any questions, feel free to ask them now or later during lunch. Thank you very much.